Welcome to our YouTube channel English Speaking Tutorial. Today we make a video on how to improve your English listening skills through English essay writing. The word essay is defined in the Concise Oxford Dictionary as a literary composition, usually prose and short, on any subjects. Properly English speaking. It is a written composition giving expression to one's own personal ideas or opinions on some topics, but the term usually covers also any written compositions, whether it expresses personal opinions or gives information on any given subjects or details of narrative or descriptions. Holidays. There is too much need of proving to most schoolboys that holidays are necessary. They are quite convinced that they are and most desirable, too. They welcome a holiday from school with hilarious joy, and plague the headmaster on the least excuse to let them off their lessons. It would be more in place to try to convince them of the necessity of work and study. Yet it may be desirable to show that regular intervals of rest, recreation, or a change of occupation are really necessary. As the old rhyme says, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. Holidays at proper intervals are especially necessary for young people, and for those engaged in hard mental work, for continuous work, without a break, will injure the health, and may cause a nervous breakdown. A short holiday, rightly used, will send us back to our work with renewed zest and vigor. Rightly used. It all depends upon that. For holidays may be abused. If the holiday is spent in stupid idleness, or in an exhausting round of exciting amusements, or shut up in close stuffy rooms drinking and playing, or in any other unhealthy way, the boy or man will come back to his work tired, listless, and uninterested. The holiday, instead of doing good, has done harm. Much more harm than steady work could ever do. How can a holiday, then, be best used, so that at the end of it we shall come back to our work with energies renewed and interest keener than ever? If we are students, or have been shut up in stuffy offices, we should get away into the pure air of the country and live a healthy, open-air life, enjoying games or sports. We should avoid unhealthy amusement, keep early hours and get plenty of refreshing sleep. And we should not be completely idle. Change of occupation is a rest. And if we have a little regular work to do, work that we take an interest in, it will make our holiday not only healthier, but more enjoyable. Books and reading. Happy is the man who acquires that habit of reading when is young. He has secured a lifelong source of pleasure, instruction and inspiration. So long as he has his beloved books, he need never feel lonely. He always has a pleasant occupation of leisure moments, so that he need never feel bored. He is the possessor of wealth more precious than gold. Ruskin calls books King's treasure filled, not with gold and silver and precious stones, but with riches much more valuable than these: knowledge, noble thoughts and high ideals. Poor indeed is the man who does not read, and empty is his life. The blessings which the reading habit confers on its possessor are many, provided we choose the right kind of books. Reading gives the highest kind of pleasure. Some books are read simply for pleasure and amusement, for example, good novels. And novels and books of imagination must have their place in everybody's reading. When we are tired, or the brain is weary with serious study, it is a healthy recreation to lose ourselves in some absorbing story written by a master hand. But to read nothing but books of fiction is like eating nothing but cakes and sweetmeats. As we need plain, wholesome food for the body, so we must have serious reading for the mind. And here we can choose according to our taste. There are many noble books on history, biography, philosophy, religion, travel, and science which we ought to read, and which will give us not only pleasure but an education. And we can develop a taste for serious reading, so that in the end it will give us more solid pleasure than even novels and books of fiction. Nor should poetry be neglected, for the best poetry gives us noble thoughts and beautiful imaginings clothed in lovely and musical language. Books are the most faithful of friends. Our friends may change, or die, but our books are always patiently waiting to talk to us. They are never cross, peevish, or unwilling to converse, as our friends sometimes are. No wonder a reader becomes a book lover. A visit to a book fair. The year 2002 was declared the year of books by the National Book Trust of India. With this note, the nation's capital played host to the World Book Fair at the trade fair Pragati Maidan. On hearing this, my friends and I expressed our eagerness to go and watch this mega festival. Our principal readily agreed, and students went by batches to be a part of this grand event. The inaugural day was marked with a walk from the Parliament House to the trade fair grounds. The book fair was indeed a spectacle to watch. There were hoardings everywhere, all for books and books for all. Each hall was segmented into many stalls managed by the respective publishing houses. Over the years, I was told by our principal about the increasing number of publishing houses. We had local publishers, national publishers, and international publishers. The book fair attracted a large number of men and women and a much larger number of children. While the stalls had the art of finesse, each stall was a delight to watch. They displayed children's books, subject-oriented books, books on language and literature, books on performing arts, science and technology books, software and hardware books, books on finance and management, books on anatomy and medicine, books on law and income tax, academic books and sponsored books. To top them all was a huge collection of dictionaries. While every stall was impressive, what attracted us most was the special seating arrangement made for enthusiastic readers by S. Chand and Company Limited. To add to this, we were all served with a cup of coffee, every one of us. The coffee relieved our fatigue, and we were 2 steps and 30 miles away from the rest of the world. There were cafeterias and ice cream parlors. I bought some books which appealed to me. As the clock struck 8, I walked home with the feeling of Francis Bacon's memorable words, "Reading maketh a full man, conference a ready man, and writing an exact man." I wish we hosted such book fairs 3 times a year so that we can be stimulated to read more and more books and broaden our visions. A House of Fire. I had never seen a house on fire before. So, one evening when I heard fire engines with loud alarm bells rushing past my house, I quickly ran out and, a few streets away, joined a large crowd of people, but we could see the fire only from a distance because the police would not allow anyone near the building on fire. What a terrible scene I saw that day! Huge flames of fire were coming out of each floor, and black and thick smoke spread all around. Every now and then tongues of fire would shoot up almost sky high, sending huge sparks of fire round about. 3 fire engines were busily engaged, and the firemen in their dark uniform were playing the hose on various parts of the building. The rushing water from several hoses soaked the building, but it did not seem to have any effect on the flames. Then the tall red ladders of the fire engine were stretched upwards, and I could see some firemen climbing up with hoses in their hands. On reaching almost the top of the ladder, they began to pour floods of water on the topmost part of the building. This continuous flooding brought the fire under control, but the building was completely destroyed. While fire is a blessing in many ways, it can also be a great danger to human life and property. The elephant. Now that the mammoth is extinct, the elephant is the largest of all animals living. And the strongest. It is a strange-looking animal, with its thick legs, huge sides and back, large hanging ears, small tail, little eyes, long white tusks, and, above all, its long nose, called the trunk. The trunk is the elephant's peculiar feature, and it puts it to various uses. It draws up water by its trunk, and can squirt it all over its body like a shower bath, and with it, it picks leaves from the trees and puts them into its mouth. In fact, its trunk serves the elephant as a long arm and hand. Elephants look very clumsy and heavy, and yet they can move very quickly when they like. Elephants are found in India and in Africa. The African elephant differs in some points from the Indian, being larger, with longer tusks and bigger cars. In fact, the two are considered to be different species. In both countries, they live in herds in the jungles, and are naturally shy animals that keep away from men. Elephants, with their great size and strength, are fine advertisement for vegetarianism, for they live entirely on leaves of trees, grass, roots and bulbs. The elephant is a very intelligent animal, and its intelligence combined with its great strength, makes it, when tamed, a very useful servant to man, and it has been trained to serve in various ways. Elephants can carry heavy loads about 1,000 seers each, and they are used to draw heavy wagons and big guns that would require many horses. They are very skillful, too, in piling timber. The trained elephant will kneel down, lift a heavy log of wood with its tusks, carry it to the place where it is wanted, and lay it exactly in position. Elephants are also trained for tiger hunting. The huntsmen sit in the howdah on the back of the elephant, which is driven and guided by the driver, called the mahout, who squats on its neck. In this way the hunters are carried through the thickest, and at such a height that they can see and fire at the tiger when it is driven out. In old days elephants were used in battles, and all Indian rajas had their regiments of trained fighting elephants. And they still have their place in state processions, when they are painted with bright colors and covered with silk and velvet clothes. In Africa elephants are hunted mainly for their tusks, which are made of ivory and are very valuable. Their skins are so thick that an ordinary bullet will not pierce them, and so large guns, called elephant guns, are used to kill the animals. Many elephants are caught alive to be tamed and trained. But catching elephants alive is difficult and dangerous work, for, though the elephant is a shy, wild animal when left alone, it can be a dangerous enemy when attacked. Elephants are generally caught alive in great traps or enclosures, called kettas. They are either driven into these kettas, or led into them by tame elephants, called decoys, which are trained to lead their wild brothers into captivity. Population of growth. One major problem that faces the world today is the rapid growth of population, often referred to as population explosion. Until about 800 AD the world's population stayed below 200 million. Since then it has risen dramatically. The rise has been greatest in the 20th century. The population has recently risen to about 6 billion, it is 3 times as large as it was in 1960. It is not so much the actual population as its rate of increase that is alarming. Experts predict that by 2020 there will be about 10 billion people, causing serious problems of hunger, overcrowding and environmental pollution. This enormous increase of population is due to better food, better hygiene and, above all, the advances made in medicine. Rapid developments in modern medicine have conquered many diseases and consequently the death rate has decreased. Until the beginning of the 19th century most people died before the age of 50. Today in developed countries the average lifespan has risen to more than 70 years. The population goes on increasing at an alarming rate in spite of the practice of birth control in many parts of the world. Thomas Malthus, a British mathematician and economist, went to the extent of declaring that, if unchecked, human population would grow in geometric progression, that is 1, 2, 4, 8 and so on, while food production could only grow in arithmetic progression, i.e., 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. He was, of course, very pessimistic. With a population of over 1 billion, India is the second most populous country in the world. China is the first. India's population has risen drastically since 1950. The population today is 2 times as large as it was in 1950. It is rising by 2.9% per year, and in consequence, every year an extra 26 million people have to be provided for. The government is taking measures to check the population growth, and a large percentage of people practice birth control. Recent advances in farming have made the country productive enough to feed the present population. Failure to arrest further increase of population may have disastrous effects, though there seems to be some truth in the statement by Julian Simon of the University of Maryland. According to him, although population growth means there will be more mouths to feed, there will be more hand to work and more brains to think. Spreading greenery for a healthy living, a thing of beauty, is a joy forever. The grandeur of a drawing room and a living room is best felt when there is an element of nature's pride possession, a tree, or an indoor plant, or even for that matter a sapling. Children as of now get to see less of greenery and more of technologically driven software parks. Fortunately, we have come to a point where we can bring the world of flora to our homes. In the emerging world scenario, interior decoration has become a passion and a dictum for healthy living. The art of planting in small pots with its branches neatly trimmed gives rise to small neat structures of plants. These plants are easy to grow indoors as long as they have soil, air, light and water. Plants can be grown in the house all year round. Of late, bonsai have attracted the attention of one and all. Botanists say that bonsai are ornamental trees or shrubs grown in a pot and artificially prevented from reaching their normal size. The Japanese specialize in bonsai and ikebana. The latter flowers are displayed according to strict rules.